Engineering and NC State. Welcome to the inaugural Dr. Hassan A. Hassan Distinguished Lecture. Before we get started, let me make a few brief remarks about the incredible career of Dr. Hassan, which led to the establishment of this distinguished lecture named in his honor. Dr. Hassan holds a Bachelor of Sciences degree in mathematics from the University of London, and an MS and a doctoral degree in aeronautical engineering from the University of Illinois. Dr. Hassan came to NC State in 1962 as a full professor and spent 53 years in the department prior to beginning phased retirement in 2015. He was one of the drivers behind creating our aerospace degree programs and initiated our strong ties to NASA Langley Research Center, which continue to this day. Additionally, he was instrumental in helping form the Mars Mission Research Center and the Hypersonic Center in the MAE department. Dr. Hassan has been the major advisor for 34 doctoral students, has authored more than 200 technical publications, and has taught many, many courses, has mentored and inspired many, many students over his career. He is the recipient of numerous awards, including the Alcoa Foundation Distinguished Engineering Award, the R.J. Reynolds Award for Excellence in Teaching, Research, and Extension, and the Alexander Holliday Medal for Excellence, which is the highest honor bestowed on a faculty member by the Board of Trustees of NC State. Dr. Hassan is also a fellow of the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics. With such a distinguished career, I can think of no better way to honor Dr. Hassan than by establishing the Hassan A. Hassan Distinguished Lecture. This lecture was made possible through the generosity of Dr. Hassan's former students and fellow MAE faculty members. Please join me in thanking Dr. Hassan for his dedication and many contributions to the MAE department over so many years.
Thank you, Rich, for this fine introduction. As a matter of fact, I mean, this award was unexpected. I mean, when I retired, just Rich stood up and said, we're going to establish this lectureship, you know, and honoring me. And of course, I received many honors in my life, but this one tops them all. I mean, this is something which I'll cherish as long as I live. In addition to Dr. Gould, I'd like to thank many others too who basically made this possible. I'd like to thank Dr. Anderson for honoring me for coming and giving the first lecture. I mean, Dr. Anderson and I go back many years ago. I mean, we worked with NASA Langley on training students for CFD. And so he's been a good friend all the time. So I appreciate this trip over here to give this lecture. Also, I want to thank Dr. Zikri. I mean, he really took upon himself the task of arranging everything. And then you get Mike Walsh. Mike, where are you, Mike? Okay, he's standing over there. He has also made all the arrangements for this visit. And I appreciate your coming, and hopefully, I mean, I'm sure we'll hear a very outstanding lecture from Dr. Anderson. Thank you all.
Wait a second. Let me now introduce Dr. Muhammad Zikri, the Zan P. Smith Distinguished Professor and Chair of the MAE Seminar Committee, to introduce our speaker.
Thanks, Rich. Thank you, Rich. Thanks, Hassan, for those kind words. It's a really unique honor and pleasure to be here today, not only to honor Hassan, but to bring Dr. Anderson to our campus. John Anderson is well known to people in engineering. I mean, he's the curator for aerodynamics at the Smithsonian National Air and Space Museum. He's also very well known as a professor of aerospace engineering at the University of Maryland. He's known for his professional and educational activities, both nationally and internationally. McGraw-Hill named his series of aerospace engineering textbooks that many of us have used an undergraduate education and graduate education as the Anderson series in clear recognition of their impact on engineering education. John has also been chairman of the Department of Aerospace Engineering at Maryland. He's been a full professor there since 1982. He was a distinguished scholar teacher in 1996. He was the Glenn Martin Distinguished Professor in Aerospace Engineering, and he retired from the University of Maryland in 1999. He's published, as you know, 11 books, more than 130 papers. He's a member of the National Academy of Engineering and honorary fellow of AIAA, and the fellow of the Royal Aeronautical Society. He received his PhD in aerospace engineering from Ohio State, and would just like to welcome him. We're very honored that he agreed to be our speaker. He was at the top of our list for this honor, and we really look forward to his lecture today.
Usually you stand up here and thank everybody. I really mean that, starting with Professor Gall and Professor Zikray. And in particular, it is such an honor. It is my honor not to be able to be here to honor Professor Hassan, whom, as he said a few minutes ago, we've known each other for a number of years. And I see some friends in the audience, people I've also known for a number of years. And so this is again, something that I am very, very pleased to do. And we're gonna start out, you know, hey, we're in North Carolina. And if I stand over here, can anybody hear me? No? Speak up. Just wanted a sound check on the mic. We get. Oh, I know. Ah. Okay. Let's try that. Okay. Sorry about that. Hey. 205 miles east of here, this flight took place December 17th, 1903. And it's as most of us know, it's the first time that an airplane, heavier than air vehicle, successfully lifted off the ground under its own power, flew in fully controlled flight, piloted over a distance that was much longer than its just initial momentum would carry it, first flight of the Wright Flyer. Now, this photograph was taken just moments after that first flight. What you have here, if we can see it, that guy right there, that's Wilbur Wright running along the right wingtip of the Wright Flyer. His orbital is prone on the flyer, and this photograph that you're looking at is, for all practical purposes, the reason that you're sitting there in this room and I'm standing here talking with you. Professor Hassan has had a career at NC State. It is the beginning. This photograph is the beginning of aeronautical engineering. And it's part of the story of aeronautical engineering that I would like to share with you today, because in particular, let's go back and do this. That airplane, this was October 14th, 1947. The first flight of a powered supersonic airplane, the Bell X-1. And when you think about the number of years between the Wright Flyer and this flight of the Bell X-1, from 1903 to 1947, that's not very long. And yet, what a tremendous breakthrough this airplane was when we became capable of flying faster than sound. And it is this flight regime, supersonic flight, that Professor Hassan has contributed greatly to over the years, going into even higher, you know, we'll talk about this at the very end, hypersonic flight. But this, the story of this airplane and the intellectual breakthroughs that made this airplane possible to break the sound barrier, October 14th, 1947, is the story that I want to tell you about. That's what we're going to be talking about. And I'm going to start out with something I call some prehistory. First of all, I usually don't do this, but I'm going to read to you an excerpt from associated with, and I'm going to go back and put this airplane back on the screen. Bear with me while I read you an excerpt of the morning of Tuesday, October 14th, 1947. Dawn bright and beautiful over Muroc Dry Lake. Getting a little bit of echo, I hope that's not bothering you. A large expanse of flat, hard surface in the Mojave Desert in California. At 6 a.m., teams of engineers and technicians at the Muroc Army Airfield began to prepare a small rocket-powered airplane for flight. Painted orange, not in that picture. You have to go to the National Air and Space Museum in Washington to see the real painted orange X-1. This is the real X-1, but a second version. Painted orange and resembling a 50 caliber machine gun bullet mated to a pair of straight stubby wings, the Bell X-1 research vehicle was carefully installed in the bomb bay of a four-engine B-29 bomber of World War II vintage. At 10 a.m., the B-29 took off and climbed to an altitude of 20,000 feet. As it rose past 5,000 feet, Captain Chuck Yeager, a veteran P-51 pilot, from the European theater during World War II, struggled into the cockpit of the X-1. Yet Yeager was in pain from two broken ribs incurred during a horseback accident the previous weekend. But not wishing to disrupt the events of the day, he informed no one except his close friend, Captain Jack Ridley, who was helping him to squeeze into the X-1 cockpit. At 10:26 a.m. and at a speed of 250 miles an hour, the brightly painted X-1 dropped free from the B-29. Yeager fired his reaction motor's rocket engine, and powered by 6,000 pounds of thrust, the sleek airplane accelerated and climbed rapidly, trailing an exhaust jet of shock diamonds. You can see them there in that picture. From four convergent divergent rocket nozzles of the engine, and those of you who are students of aerodynamics know what convergent divergent rocket engines are, the X-1 was soon flying faster than Mach 0.85, the speed beyond which there were no wind tunnel data in 1947, and beyond which no one knew what problems might be encountered in transonic flight. Entering that unknown realm, Yeager momentarily shut down two of the four rocket chambers and carefully tested the controls of the X-1 as the Mach meter in the cockpit registered 0.95 and still increasing. The small invisible shock waves were dancing back and forth over the top surface of the wings. At an altitude of 40,000 feet, the X-1 began to level off, and Yeager fired one of the two shut down rocket chambers. The Mach meter moved smoothly through 0.98 and 0.99 to reach 1.02. There the meter hesitated, then jumped to 1.06. A stronger bow shock wave was formed in the air ahead of the needle nose of the X-1. As Yeager reached a velocity of 700 miles an hour, Mach 1.06 at 43,000 feet. The flight was smooth, there was no violent buffeting of the airplane, no loss of control, as had been feared by some engineers. At that moment, Yeager became the first pilot to fly faster than the speed of sound. And the small streamlined Bell X-1 became the first supersonic airplane, the first supersonic airplane in the history of flight. Just a little bit more. As the sonic boom from the X-1 propagated across the California desert, that flight became the most significant milestone in human flight since the Wright brothers' first flight at Kill Devil Hills 44 years earlier. That was the previous photograph. That flight was equally significant in the history of scientific accomplishments, when you think about that. For as one of those high points in 260 years of research into the mysteries of high-speed gas dynamics and aerodynamics. I mean, what went behind, the intellectual developments that went behind this airplane that allowed this airplane to be properly designed and properly flown, you're talking about 260 years of research previous to the flight of that airplane. And in particular, it was the climax of 23 years of outstanding research in high-speed aerodynamics carried out by the NACA. For those, some of you, the younger people in the audience, that of course was the predecessor of the of today's NASA. The NACA, research that is one of the most important stories in the history of aeronautical engineering. And that's the story that I want to share with you today. The intellectual development, understanding high-speed, the motion of high-speed gases, understanding high-speed flight. This Bell X-1 broke the speed of sound. What is the speed of sound? I'm going to go into a little bit of prehistory, and that's our next item here, so let's put that on the screen. Prehistory. And once we talk about the prehistory, I'm going to explain something that's called the compressibility problem. And then we'll look at how to deal with that compressibility problem. But first of all, you know, the speed of sound. When I was when I teach aerodynamics at the University of Maryland, a lot of the stuff you teach seems to be pretty new. What about the speed of sound? Is that pretty new information? For those of you in the audience, first of all, you may know the what I call the golfer's rule of thumb. Now, if you're out on the golf course and you see a thunderstorm coming off up in the distance, and you see a flash of lightning, and you start counting, one, two, three, four, five. For every count of five, that lightning was a mile away. So clearly, it takes time for sound to propagate through the air. The sound has a certain speed through the air. And the question is, what is it? What is the speed of sound? How much, how fast is it? Well, in the middle 1600s, the speed of sound was measured. And it was measured kind of using the idea of this golfer's rule of thumb, because a cannon would be put on top of a hill way far out there in the distance. There'd be somebody standing here with a little stopwatch. And you see the muzzle flash out there. You start timing the amount of time before you hear the blast from the cannon. And you measure the speed of sound. And in the middle of the 17th century, the speed of sound was measured to be about 1,140 feet per second. Well, hey, in this room, more or less at standard sea level conditions, the speed of sound is 1,117 feet per second, or 340 meters per second. We know that today. In the middle of the 17th century, it was measured pretty closely, 1,140 feet per second. When did we first calculate the speed of sound? Along comes Isaac Newton, and in the Principia in 1687, in book two, dealing with fluid dynamics, he has a calculation of the speed of sound. He calculates a value of 987 feet per second, about 15% less than the measured value. But let me tell you, those of us who are engineers and scientists, you know, you learn to rationalize. Newton rationalized, and he said, well, the difference must be due to dust particles in the air, humidity in the air. In reality, Newton had made an incorrect approximation, incorrect approximation about the nature of for those of you who are engineering students, I'll say the thermodynamic nature of the process through a sound wave. Newton assumed it was isothermal, constant temperature through the sound wave. And that was the reason why he came in at 15, made a calculation, 15% less. And it was about 100 years later when Laplace, the great French mathematician Laplace, comes along and makes the correct decision. He said, well, process is adiabatic. Today we'd call it isentropic. And Laplace, making the proper assumption, calculated properly the speed of sound. So look, the knowledge of the speed of sound, how to measure it, how to calculate it, man, that was known at the time of Napoleon. So it's pretty old stuff. Okay, I mentioned in what I read to you that the X1 encountered some shockwaves. Shockwaves. You know, what are shockwaves? Well, basically, shockwaves are just, if I had a flow coming in here at faster than the speed of sound, I stick my hand in that flow, and I don't advise you to do that, but if I did, there'd be this thin region in front of my hand called a shockwave. Thinner than a piece of paper. And across that thin region, the pressure is going to jump way up, depending on conditions. It could go from one atmosphere in this room in front of the shock to maybe 10 atmospheres right behind the shock. Now, this little fluid element then goes from one atmosphere and bang, through the shock wave, 10 atmospheres. And if that were me, I don't know about you, if that were me and that happened to me, I'd be shocked out of my mind, and that's, I'm sure, why we call these things shock waves. Now, what about shock waves? Well, shock waves, the existence of shock waves was theorized in the early 1800s. People witnessed that there were these big bangs that every once in a while had explosions that happened in coal mines, in the shafts of coal mines. And so there was an attempt to try to calculate properties across a shock wave. John Rankine at the University of Glasgow in 1870 came up with the equations that allow you to calculate properties across a shock wave, a normal shock wave. And 17 years later in France, Yogonio came up independently with the same equations. And so by 1887, there was the ability, the equations existed for calculating properties across shock waves. Now, what about the existence of a shock wave? You're looking at a photograph taken by Ernst Mach, 1887. This is a photograph of essentially a .22 caliber bullet moving from left to right. And what you see is a shock wave in front of that bullet. Mach took this, used an optical system called a shotograph, and showed for the first time, this photograph is the first time that human beings actually saw a shockwave. 1887. That was a long time ago. So this information about speed of sound, shockwaves, the kind of information that you needed to know if you're going to go off and design the X1, that was known back before the beginning of the 20th century. Now, I want to share with you something here. Almost kind of a timeout. We're going to get a little philosophical for a moment. What I've just shared with you is what you might call science. We have science and we have engineering. What is science? I'm going to use there's a wonderful book written by a very thoughtful aerodynamicist, historian of technology, Stanford professor by the name of Walter Vincenti. It's a book called What Engineers Know and How They Know It. This is something I really recommend. If you haven't seen this book, I recommend that you take a look at this. This is a book that has about 7 case histories taken from aeronautical engineering. And Walter Vincenti is trying to to very intelligently and thoughtfully try to figure out what engineers know and how they know it. And he, at the beginning, he defines science, and it makes plenty of sense. Science is that activity for, science is the acquisition of new knowledge for the explicit purpose of just acquiring that new knowledge. Gets published maybe in the literature, in journal papers, gets put in the library. That's science. What's engineering? Engineering is a totally different bulk of information for the single purpose of designing something, designing an artifact, he would say. That's what engineering is. And a lot of people will say, well, engineering is applied science. Vincenti argues that's not quite right. Engineering is its own developed bulk of knowledge for the purpose of designing stuff. Sometimes you even go against, use laws that you know are not quite physically correct, but it works for something, and you design it, and it works. What I've just shared with you, this matter of the speed of sound and shock waves and the equations of shock waves, that's science. All that information was put in the library, and finally, during the World War II, beginning of the design of the Bell X-1, that information was in the library, ready to be used. Now, Professor Hassan has done, Hassan has done a lot of research work over the years, like many of us have in this audience, and the many of the younger generation here, the students, you will do over your career. Now, where does that fit? There is this middle gray area, which I would call engineering science. You know, what is engineering science? Well, engineering science is the acquisition of new knowledge, but for the purpose, ultimately, of designing an artifact. That's what engineering science is. And for the rest of our discussion here, I'm going to share with you a story that is engineering science. And many of you, in your careers have worked in and will continue to work in as you graduate and mature in your field, you will do engineering science. So, let's begin. First of all, I'm going to very quickly, you never should show graphs that look like this. This was taken out of a German publication in 1910. But basically, this is something called a drag coefficient versus velocity for an artillery shell. Measured by Benzmerg and Kranz in Germany in 1910, this shows as the velocity of the shells approached something like 340 meters per second, the speed of sound, the drag is going up very rapidly. And then on the side where the shells are moving faster than the speed of sound, this drag coefficient is actually going down. Now, for those of you who have studied aerodynamics, you know that doesn't mean the drag is going down. That would be neat, wouldn't it? If you start flying at supersonic speeds, all you have to do is sit back and just coast the rest of the way out to Mach 30. But the thing is that the drag coefficient, as you know, is multiplied by the square of the velocity as well as the density and reference area, and to give you the drag. The velocity is still going up by the square, and so your drag is going up. But the key is, look, there is a big increase in drag near Mach 1. Where's big increase in drag? Now, this is drag, artillery shells. This was 7 years after the Wright brothers had flown at Kitty Hawk. The Wright brothers were concerned with drag, but they were really concerned with lift. What about lift? What happens to lift on an airplane wing or even just an airfoil section when you start flying close to the speed of sound? Well, let's take a look at that. In 1918, two guys at McCook Field in Dayton, Ohio. McCook Field was the Army research technical aeronautical technical facility that was sort of set up in Dayton at about the same time the NACA established the Langley Memorial Aeronautical Laboratory in Hampton. And in McCook Field, these two guys, Frank Colwell and Elisha Fales, designed a wind tunnel. And this wind tunnel in 1918 had the capability of going from 25 miles an hour to 465 miles an hour. Still a typo, not a typo. I need to put an MPH on that. Miles per hour. But look, think about that. This is 1918. 1918, these guys had a wind tunnel capable of generating 465 miles an hour. It's a fairly big wind tunnel. It's about 15 or so feet long. Had 11-inch diameter test section. In 1918, the fastest fighter plane, something on the order of like the French SPAD 13 from World War I, 120 to 130 miles an hour. And here we have the Army in 1918 building a wind tunnel 465 miles an hour, capable of that. Now, why is that? Is that because people in the U.S. Army had this forward-looking prescience, could say one of these days soon we're going to be flying airplanes at 465 miles an hour? Do you think that's what they were thinking of? That was not what they were thinking of. Why do you think they designed a tunnel to do 465 miles an hour? Any thoughts? Well, I'm not supposed to ask people to think. Yes?
Perhaps they wanted to test actually,
that's a good point. Because they were the Army and they were concerned with artillery shells. This is a very good point. However, they didn't use this wind tunnel for artillery shells because they put wing models in it. Yes? Pardon?
Propeller.
Yes. There's always somebody who's... I don't want to call you a ringer, but you know the answer. Frank Colwell and Elisha Fales were members of the propeller research group at McCook Field. In that SPAD 13 I was mentioning, they may have flying along forward velocity 120 miles an hour, but that propeller is rotating like mad in front of it. And you go out to the tip of that propeller. If you were glued to the tip of that propeller, you'd be moving pretty fast through the air. It's like the old style vinyl records. Vinyl records are coming back these days, I hear. We got rid of our turntables, unfortunately, a few years ago. But if you visualize a record turntable, you know right at the center, things move around pretty slowly. You put something on the tip of the record, and it's moving like mad. The tips of propellers move fast. And if you combine the forward velocity of the airplane with the translational velocity of the tip of the propeller and its rotational motion, you can get up, and propeller tips did get up close to the speed of sound. And that's bad news for propellers, because when you get up close to the speed of sound, you begin to get the possibility of little shock waves out at the tip of the propeller, and the propeller efficiency would go to pot. And that was a concern, even during World War I, of aeronautical engineers in terms of propellers. And so these guys at McCook Field, they were interested not so much in drag, but what happens, a propeller, going back to Orville Wilbur-Wright, Wilbur-Wright was the first person who really realized that a propeller is nothing other than a twisted wing like this, rotating around the air. And what we'd call the lift on the wing is really the forward thrust on the propeller. And so what happens to that forward thrust on the propeller, or the lift, quote unquote, when the tip of the propeller, what happens to that airfoil section out there when you get close to the speed of sound? So they were interested in the effect on lift of high speeds. And this is a strange looking graph. Again, This is called the lift coefficient versus velocity. They put a little wing model in the test section, and they measured the lift coefficient. In those days, it was defined so that, for those of you who know about lift coefficients, today our lift coefficients are twice as large as what's shown here. That 0.5 would really be a lift coefficient of 1. Forget about this part of the curve. These are sort of low Reynolds numbers. In fact, what's really important is when you got out here to high speeds, look at this. The lift coefficient suddenly drops off the cliff. My gosh, it drops off the cliff. And Caldwell and Fales called the velocity at which this occurred critical velocity, when the lift drops off the cliff. And that was the beginning of what today we define as the critical Mach number for an airfoil or for a wing. This was 1918. Now, look, the lift falls off the cliff. The drag they know is going up and out of sight, and they don't have a clue as to fundamentally what is causing this. Now, this is where the engineering science comes in. This is where some research starts coming in to try to figure out, learn more information to design an artifact, namely a propeller that's going to operate properly. A few years later, the NACA again contracted with Briggs and Dryden, Hugh Dryden. Hugh Dryden is famous for later on becoming director of research for NASA. Hugh Dryden, just a little time out for a minute. These guys were working for the National Bureau of Standards since 1924. Hugh Dryden had graduated in 1919 with a PhD from Johns Hopkins University. At the age of 19, he at that time had obtained, he was the youngest student to graduate with a PhD from Johns Hopkins University. I think that record still holds. I need to look into that. And what was his PhD dissertation topic on? High-speed flows. Just what Professor Hassan has been working in, and me as well, some of us in the audience. High-speed flows. Nevertheless, Briggs and Dryden carried out, they designed a little wing model, and then they, up in the General Electric Lynn Works in Massachusetts, they had a facility they sort of jury-rigged to produce a flow at the end of a pipe that was close to the speed of sound. And they measured over a wing model such things as the lift decreased dramatically beyond this critical speed, just had been observed earlier. That the drag increased dramatically, just had been noted earlier by the artillery measurements. Something called the center of pressure shifts rearward. The critical speed at which these occur decreases as the angle of attack increases. You pitch the wing to a higher angle of attack, your critical speed at which you encounter these bad effects becomes lower, et cetera, et cetera. So they are verifying what the researchers at McCook Field had done. And then just again about 3 years later, 2 years later, 1926, again contracted by the NACA. And by the way, for those of you who have worked for the NACA and maybe still work for the NACA, I consider this story, this little history I'm going through, you'll appreciate is a tremendous success story in the history of the NACA. But anyway, we'll get there in a minute. What these guys did in 1926, again, nobody knew what was causing these adverse effects. Now, they're beginning to call them compressibility effects. What was causing these adverse compressibility effects? Lift dropping off the cliff, the drag going out of sight. And so Briggs and Dryden, in a different facility, the Edgewood Arsenal up in Maryland, in a smaller facility, built a wing model of about a little two-inch cord, and they put two pressure taps in that wing model. And they had about six of these wing models, and they put the two pressure taps at different locations, chord-wise locations, so they could actually get a pressure distribution over the airfoil. Their experiments at the critical speed indicated flow separation. The flow looked like it was popping off the top surface of the airfoil. The flow was separating off of the top surface of the airfoil. The airfoil was at 0 degrees angle of attack. Now, it was known by that time that when an airplane wing stalls, just ordinary stall, you pitch it up to 15, 16, 18 degrees angle of attack, the wing stalls. It was known that that stall was being caused by flow separation off the top surface of the wing. And as a matter of fact, again, at NACA Langley in the early 1920s, there were flight experiments carried out with pressure taps on the wings of airplanes where they measured what the pressure distribution was when the airplane went into a stall. And they found that when the airplane went into a stall, the pressure on the top surface of the wing suddenly plateaus straight across. That was what happened in the separated flow region. Well, these guys saw a pressure distribution that was basically plateaued out, a flat pressure distribution. To them, that indicated flow separation, and yet these wings, the little wing models, they were down at 0 degrees angle of attack. But yet the flow was clearly separating, and they went and verified that. They smeared oil, pigmented oil on the surface of the wing. And again, you can look at the little lines of flow in that oil flow on the surface of the wing, and you can detect flow separation. And sure enough, the flow was separating off the top surface of the wing, top surface of the airfoil. Now, when these adverse compressibility effects occurred, now that's a piece of intellectual information. That's kind of important. But the next thought is, what was causing the flow to separate? It's pretty well known what caused the flow to separate when you have a wing, your airplane stalls out at high angle of attack, you have an adverse pressure gradient downstream over the airfoil, causes the flow to separate. But what was causing it to separate here? This, and again, nobody really knew. Now, in 1928, this guy comes along. This is John Stack, fresh new graduate from MIT in aeronautical engineering. He walks into the front gate of the NACA Langley Memorial Laboratory, and he is immediately assigned to work, more or less immediately, in a relatively new facility, a high-speed wind tunnel. This high-speed wind tunnel looked like this. Here's a room. Like we're in the room here, right here, here's a room. And above in the ceiling of that room, there's this duct up here. And at the back end of that duct, there is an ejector. Yeah, now, this is coming from a high pressure, this gets detailed. At Langley, in those days, there was another historic facility, which is another presentation, called the variable density wind tunnel. It was a big tank pressurized to 20 atmospheres, and you put a wind tunnel inside that 20 atmosphere tank. Variable density wind tunnel. So you get what's called high Reynolds numbers. Well, when a test was finished in that variable density tunnel, that 20 atmospheres, you had to do something with it, and it was just exhausted to the atmosphere. For this, they exhausted that variable density wind tunnel at 20 atmospheres through ejectors, and that high-speed ejector sucked the air from this reservoir up through this nozzle. And right there at the minimum area of the nozzle is a wing model. And there John Stack, on that wing model, measured really for the first time, truly very exhaustive, detailed data on lift coefficient, drag coefficient, versus velocity over an airfoil. This is a standard airfoil. This is a Clark Y airfoil, an old style airfoil. And look what's happening. Same old thing. The lift up at a high speed here, dropping off the cliff. The drag is going out of sight. And now, by now, it was understood that that was being caused by flow separation when this ratio, this velocity, achieves a certain critical value. Now, a timeout for a minute. This is velocity of the airflow divided by velocity of the speed of sound. Now, today, we know that's Mach number. Velocity divided by the speed of sound. The Mach number was coined in 1928, fairly, you know, wasn't all. Ernst Mach, I showed you his photograph. He didn't turn around and say, okay, I'm going to define the ratio of velocity divided by the speed of sound after me. No, it was 1928 when a German aerodynamicist, Jakob Akrit, in a speech, defined this ratio as Mach number, 1928. That was in Europe. Now, you know, today, you define something new, and it goes out all over the world at the speed of electrons. In 1928, it would go out all over the world at the speed of a paper, a journal paper, or something that floated across the ocean on a boat. Anyway, it was slow to get around. And I researched this. It took about 10 years for the term Mach number to finally, at least in the United States, be used. This is a report that was published in 1934. Again, the NACA was very definitive, very careful about what it published. This ratio is Mach number, but it wasn't called that because we didn't call it that in 1934. And finally, about 1938, I found some NACA technical reports that started talking about Mach number, using this ratio and defining it as Mach number. So anyway, time is back in. This is Mach number right here. And what we see, the usual stuff, the lift falling off the cliff, the drag going out of sight, beyond a critical Mach number, but still, the story wasn't complete. This engineering science story wasn't complete because even though it was recognized the flow was separate at this critical speed, the flow was separating off the top surface of the airfoil. Why? Why was it separating off the top surface of the airfoil? And also at the same time, by the way, it was interesting. There was no theory to speak of, to allow aerodynamic calculations to be made near the speed of sound, transonic speed ranges. For those of you in the audience who know, have studied some mathematics and aerodynamics, the governing equations for this flow are nonlinear partial differential equations. Sound horrible. And they're hard to solve. The aerodynamic flow, the equations of motion around Mach 1 are nonlinear partial differential equations that can't be simplified and couldn't be solved. There was no rational transonic theory at that time. And there were no transonic wind tunnels at that time that could really give you accurate information right at and around Mach 1. Because these little shock waves that start occurring, they'd bounce up and down above the top and bottom of the wind tunnel and destroy your data. And so this was a problem. John Stack recognized that, and he began thinking about the only way to figure out this stuff is actually build an airplane and fly it at transonic speeds. And I found this graph mucking around in the Langley archives a while back in the John Stack files. And I found this graph right here. Now, for those of you who may have studied something called airplane performance, you might recognize this as a power required curve. That's the power required to fly an airplane at certain speeds. And John Stack was looking at the power required when you had these bad compressibility effects the power required if you could mitigate those a little bit. But he was thinking about a research airplane. This is his own piece of graph paper. This was a rusty paperclip up there. And I found this was sandwiched in the JohnStack files in between two IRS forms. I mean, you have to, you know, one thing I've learned from my historical comrades, you have to look for things. And anyway, JohnStack initially had the first real idea for a research airplane. He proposed it to the NACA management at Langley. It got nowhere. It went up to headquarters. It got nowhere. And it just didn't happen. But nevertheless, he was thinking along those lines. Now, also, said a lot of this research work was generated because of interest in propellers. Well, you know, propellers are important, but they're not showstoppers. But in 1931, this airplane, Submarine S-6B, this is designed by R.J. Mitchell, the same guy who designed the British Spitfire. This won the Snyder Cup trophy in 1931 for Britain, and at the speed of this plane, 340 miles an hour, closed course over the ocean. They had to be seaplanes. That's why there's a pontoon on. And then the same airplane later on in October of 1931 reached 401 miles per hour. And at that time, people like JohnStack realized that, wait a minute, these compressibility problems, this need to know what was causing these problems, this now is going to affect the whole airplane. And that is a showstopper. So in the 1930s, the interest and the need to know this information really ramped up. Now, and again, we didn't know, people didn't know, ultimately what was causing these adverse compressibility problems. JohnStack worked for this person, Eastman Jacobs, who in his own right was very famous for designing, among other things, a series of NACA airfoils, including the laminar flow airfoil later on in the late 30s. JohnStack worked for Jacobs, and Jacobs was an amateur astronomer who knew optical systems. He suggested to JohnStack, let's put some kind of optics across our wind tunnel and look at the flow and see what's happening in that flow. And they did that. They put a Schlieren system, what's called a Schlieren system, across the flow. This is what they saw. This is a symmetric NAC airfoil, symmetric airfoil, flow moving from left to right, zero angle of attack. And what is this? That's a shockwave emanating from the top of the airfoil and below the airfoil. This is the first ever photograph of a shockwave occurring on an airfoil, period. And it explained the basic reason for these compressibility effects. Because lo and behold, even though the wind speed in the wind tunnel was less than the speed of sound, we know that the flow expands to higher speeds over the airfoil. There's a pocket of supersonic flow here. It's terminated by a shock wave. And that shock wave, remember I said, is a thin region across which the pressure goes way up. The thin boundary layer along the surface was separated by that shock wave. So the flow separates. So what was causing these adverse compressibility effects? Flow separation. What was causing the flow separation? Shock waves occurring on the surface of the airfoil. And so from that point of view, the story was complete. Now this was an intellectual breakthrough that was really dramatic in those days. I want to read to you one little excerpt. This was an excerpt written by another engineer at Langley, John Becker, talking about these tests. Now, by the way, that's not a very clear photograph because the windows of the wind tunnel were made out of celluloid. I mean, they didn't try hard to have a nice a high-quality optical clearance system with high-quality glass. They were just interested in looking in the flow, make a stab at it, and so they had celluloid for the windows. And this is what Becker said about these. The first tests were actually made on a circular cylinder, not an airfoil, about a half an inch in diameter, and the results were spectacular in spite of the poor quality of the optics. Shock waves and attendant flow separations were seen for the first time, starting at subsonic stream speeds about 6/10 times the speed of sound. Visitors from all over the laboratory, from engineer in charge H.J.E. Reed, an engineer in charge, that's the director of Langley, came to view the phenomena. Langley's ranking theorist, Theodore Theodorsen, viewed the results skeptically. This is kind of interesting when you think about what you may do in the future. Theodore Theodorsen viewed the results skeptically, proclaiming that since the stream flow was subsonic, what appeared to be shock waves was, quote, an optical illusion, an error in judgment which he was never allowed to forget. So you have to be careful about jumping to conclusions even today in technical work. This was a dramatic breakthrough. And within a year, this was written up in a paper. Now, the John Stat, it was written up in a paper and presented at what was called the Fifth Volta Conference in Rome. The Fifth Volta Conference was a major conference on high-speed flight, held in an old Rome, historic building in Rome. It was by invitation only. Only the most famous aerodynamicists were invited to this. People like Theodor von Karman from the United States, Prandtl from Germany, and so on and so forth. But the Eastman Jacobs, being Stack's boss, Stack didn't get the invitation, but Eastman Jacobs got the invitation. So Eastman Jacobs went to Rome, gave a paper at the Fifth Volta Conference, which knocked the socks off the audience. It was the first time that this audience of distinguished aerodynamicists had ever really realized that shock waves occurred on the surface of the airfoil, and that these shock waves were causing the adverse compressibility effects. So again, a piece of intellectual information. But this is, again, this is not science. This is what I call engineering science. This information is being learned in order to design something like, eventually, the Bell X1. Now, we're almost finished. Let me continue just a few more times. Of course, there's Theodorsen, and I have to show you that. He's the one who was skeptical about this. This stuff became really serious. The Lockheed P-38 was the first airplane to encounter truly serious compressibility effects. When the P-38 would go into a high-speed terminal dive, there'd be a tendency for the tail, put it in a terminal dive, the pilot couldn't pull it out. It's called a tuck under problem because the tail was always trying to tuck the airplane under like this. Ralph Erdin was one of Lockheed's best test pilots, was killed in 1941 in a test of a P-38. This was a serious problem, especially since in the early 1940s, there were thousands of P-38s on the production line. What can you do? Once again, John Stack and his crew at Langley, with some people at the new Ames Laboratory out in California, recognized that these bad compressibility effects encountered during the high-speed dive, shock waves off the wings, changed the lift on the wing, and there is a downwash, there's a flow of air behind the wing called downwash, which is affected by that lift. If there's a loss of lift, the angle of that downwash is affected. The tail back here now suddenly sees a different airflow coming at it at a higher angle of attack. The tail, being the tail, says, aha, I've got to produce more lift. Tail does, airplane, a tail produces more lift, airplane tucks under, and that's the tuck under problem. The solution to that problem, again, as suggested by the NACA crew, was simply a little flap put underneath the wing, about 30% of the, it was underneath the wing, 30% of the chord line, downstream of the leading edge. Just a little flap about the, it's about the height of my arm, spanning this long. And what that did was get the lift back up on the wing and get the downwash angle back to where it's supposed to be, and the tail seeing the angle of attack is supposed to be seeing. It wasn't, it didn't slow the airplane down. It wasn't intended to slow the airplane down. It was intended to affect and increase the lift. And it was this understanding of the nature, the physical nature of these adverse compressibility effects that allowed the NACA engineers to make this fix. And these dive recovery flaps were used not only in the P-38, but on the P-47 Thunderbolt. Later on the Lockheed P-80, our first real production line jet airplane. So it was a major engineering application of this engineering science that took place beforehand. This is just to show you that for the P-38 in a terminal, this is the critical Mach number right there. In a terminal dive, the P-38 went well beyond the critical Mach number, and that's the source of its problems. And finally, if we were sitting here in 1947, we would know, if you look at drag versus Mach number, this low-speed subsonic portion is pretty well known how to deal with that. The supersonic portion of the drag coefficient is pretty well known how to deal with that, but you had this, still had this unknown transonic gap because there was no theory that worked. There were no wind tunnel data that worked. And so the choice was to build an airplane. And this orange-painted Bell X-1 was the airplane that was built and proved that you can break the sound barrier without real adverse compressibility effects. And finally, the Collier Trophy. The Collier Trophy is awarded every year for the most important contribution to aeronautics. In 1948, the Collier Trophy was awarded to three people for the Bell X-1. The pilot, Chuck Yeager. The manufacturer, Larry Bell. And scientist, John Stack. John Stack was a dyed-in-the-wool, hardcore aeronautical engineer. But scientists, think about this for a minute. Even today, when a space shot works beautifully, you know, there's a successful space shot, satellite goes into orbit, everything works beautifully, scientists have succeeded again. If that thing blows up on the pad, the engineers have fouled up again. I mean, it just happens. And here we have John Stack being labeled as scientist. Now I have to, if truth be known, it was at Langley in the NACA in those days, the job descriptions of people like John Stack were called aeronautical scientists, not engineers, but I have to make that point. Finally, we're almost finished. There's John Stack again. He got his second Collier Trophy. In 1953, because he helped to develop finally the solution for transonic wind tunnels called the slotted throat wind tunnel. You put some slots in the top wall and the bottom wall in the flow direction, and those shock waves that are going bouncing up and down kind of let them pass through to a certain extent. And that was the first time that successful transonic wind tunnel testing was carried out. John Stack I know I've gone over, but just a few more moments. John Stack became he became associate director of Langley in the late 1950s. In 1958, when NASA was formed, 2 years later, 1960, John Stack goes up to NASA headquarters to become director of aeronautics. 2 years later, he retires. He's eligible for retirement, very disgruntled, because in 1962, the aeronautics part of NASA's budget was really small, and he was objecting to that. The same thing, is, of course, as we know, is happening today. It happens every year. The aeronautics part is very small compared to space. But John Stack retired. He became vice president of Republic Aircraft. And 2 years later, Republic was bought by Fairchild and became vice president for research at Fairchild. In 1972, he retired to his farm. He owned a farm in Yorktown, Virginia. In 1973, while riding his horse, quite a horseman, riding his horse out on the farm, John Stack fell off the horse and was killed. Today, Stack is buried in the Grace Episcopal Church graveyard in Yorktown. And I have to say that I have to think, he's there. You know, that graveyard is on the flight path from Langley Air Force Base of F-22s and now F-35s, airplanes capable and supersonic airplanes. John Stack helped pave the way towards the intellectual knowledge to design those airplanes. And I have to say, he must be lying there looking up and smiling. And then finally, what are we doing today? This is a hypersonic test vehicle, X-51. And I'm showing this really in honor of Professor Hassan, because Hassan has worked in the field of hypersonic aerodynamics. I mean, we've gone well beyond Mach 1 now, well beyond the Bell X-1. We are talking about hypersonic air. We've been talking about hypersonic airplanes for a number of decades. And still an experimental airplane. Doesn't have a pilot in it, but it's an experimental airplane designed to acquire new knowledge. Not just for the acquisition of new knowledge to put in the library, but new knowledge to help design later on engineering artifacts like hypersonic aircraft. And the man whom we are honoring today in this lecture, sitting right here in front of me, helped to contribute to the overall knowledge base of hypersonic aerodynamics. There are other people in the audience. I have recognized Lee Beach sitting here in the second row, who also helped a lot to contribute to the propulsion system in this vehicle. And I have to end with this, that the story goes on. And there are those of you I see out there. I mean, seriously, this is what university professors do with good reason. I see a lot of bright faces out there. And though some of you will have the opportunity to contribute to aircraft programs that are follow-ons to what you see here on the screen. But what went before this vehicle is work like the work carried out by Professor Hassan. And so that's the end of my story. I'm 12 minutes over time, but nevertheless, I wanted to share this story to you. It's a story of intellectual achievement. It's a wonderful story in my mind from the history of aerodynamics that really has had and continues to have an impact on flight vehicles that we deal with today. So I'm finished, and we still do have some time for questions.
Thank you very much. That was a great talk, and we're ready for some questions.
Yes.
Let me just get the microphone to you.
With respect to the compressibility, if you go over the area, you have great
The question was, can you go over the area of compressibility?
Oh, yes. The area rule, yes. Yes, yes. So, that's another presentation. I didn't bring the right slide for that. Seriously. Here's the area rule. And that's also a story in understanding the aspects of compressibility. The area rule says the following. I showed you an artillery shell. It was actually a 22 caliber bullet there. When you look at an artillery shell or a bullet, and you would take a knife and slice this thing like a carrot, like this, and look at the segments that you slice, look at the area of those segments. The area distribution as a function of distance longitudinally along, in this case, let's say an airplane. If that area distribution is nice and smooth, nice smooth variation, it tends to have a low drag. But if you slice that carrot, slice the airplane, and you suddenly have a big increase in area of the slice, like you would have if you're coming along the fuselage of an airplane from the nose down towards the wing, and you suddenly slice it in the wing area, and the area, cross-sectional area of the wing start adding up, and you suddenly have these big cross-sectional areas. That can cause high drag at transonic speeds. And that's the area rule that you're referring to. And it was a problem. That was the source of the reason for the area rule, because in the early 1950s, Convair designed a neat little delta wing airplane called the F-102. And it was designed to be one of our Century Series fighters. The Century Series fighters were going to be fighters who could fly faster than the speed of sound, Mach 1.2, 0.3, something like that. So along comes the F-102. Convair designs this. It's got hundreds of them on the production line. The airplane is tested in flight, and it could not break the speed of sound. Why? Well, ultimately, it had to do again with the fact that you have these waves, shock waves and so forth, coming off of particularly in the region around the wings, where suddenly the area, cross-sectional area, increased, that caused high pressure on the fuselage of the wings, caused higher drag. The airplane could not break the speed of sound. This is also another example, in this case, of the NACA success, because an NACA engineer, whom many of you have heard about, Richard Whitcomb, sort of suspected this was going on, and in the tunnels at Langley, carried out experiments. He rationalized that if you maintain a cross-sectional area distribution going along the axis of the airplane that is smooth and well-behaved, then you're not going to encounter this high drag. So how do you do that when you come into the wing? All of a sudden, here's a wing, and the cross-sectional area goes up. Well, the answer is take the area away from the fuselage. And so the idea of the area rule, it's called the transonic area rule, was to maintain a relatively well-behaved, not uniform area, but a well-behaved, smooth variation of a cross-sectional area, even in the wing area. And if you neck the fuselage down in the wing area, you take cross-sectional area away from the fuselage, the wing is adding to it, and you still maintain a nice, smooth, well-behaved area distribution. That was the area rule. And that had everything to do with these compressibility effects, with the waves, the compression waves, associated with the flow around the airplane in the fuselage region, particularly when you get back to the wings. Does that make sense to you? Yes, that's what.
Done there.
Good for you. Would you like to add to this explanation? I'll always add.
I had the privilege of flying
Yes. Yeah, yes, right.
And I appreciate the people who designed that magnificent airplane, the F-106.
Yes. Well, even the F-102A, finally, with the error rule, did break the speed of sound. But the F-106 was that much better.
The 102 could reach about 1.5.
Yeah, right. And the 106 went up to Mach 2?
2.3. It set a speed record of 1,526.96 miles per hour.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Beautiful airplane.
Beautiful.
My compliments to everybody that had lines on the paper for that airplane.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, well, thank you. And I'll just say again, I mean, that is an example of why people did this engineering science research to try to explain problems, the compressibility problems in high-speed flight. Very good point. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the valuable information and the history. I was wondering if you have any insights or opinions regarding the companion research that was being done in Germany and England. You mentioned von Karman. I wonder if you have any insights into how that supported these developments or may have been some competition.
Yeah. That's a really good question, because as you know, as many of us know, particularly in the 20s and the 30s, when you look for a leader in engineering, a leader in science, Germany was a leader in spite of the fact that they lost the First World War. The common scientific language in those days was German, for good reasons, because most of the technical literature was in German, the fundamental literature. In terms of looking at high-speed flows, the Germans were doing, they were not doing the kind of work that I related to you here. They didn't have an idea. They didn't know the basic idea as to why the lift was dropping off the cliff and the drag was going out of sight. They didn't know what was causing that. I don't think they were really concerned in those days. But then along comes the late 1930s. Two things happen. In Germany, suddenly there's a real resurgence due to the resurgence in aeronautics and the interest in aeronautics, the design of airplanes due to the fact the Nazis coming to power. And secondly, the idea of a swept wing came from a German. Again, in the same Volta conference that I mentioned in 1935, the concept of the swept wing was introduced. The Adolf Bussmann was the person who did that. And nobody at that conference paid any attention to the idea of a swept wing. Bussmann presented a paper saying, look, the way, if we're going to fly at high speeds, we need to sweep the wings of an airplane. And he was thinking of supersonic speeds. Nobody paid attention to him. Von Karman attended that. Von Karman, in his autobiography, The Wind and Beyond, comments on it and admits that he had forgotten about Bussmann's presentation for a couple of years. The Germans didn't forget. And within about 6 months after that presentation, the Luftwaffe classified the idea of swept wings. And at the end of World War II, when the Allied intelligence teams went into the German laboratories and discovered this tremendous bulk of research on swept wings, even for subsonic flight, to try to get to deal with this critical Mach number problem. And one way of reducing the drag and getting your critical Mach number closer to one, of course, is to sweep the wings. That's why all the commercial transports today, most all of them have swept wings. But the Germans then, you know, went from like zero work to lots of work on how to deal with drag reduction, particularly at these high speeds near Mach 1. So, but prior to that, As I said, they didn't do anything. When Eastman Jacobs gave his paper at the Volta conference, again, it knocked the socks off of a lot of the people there, because they had no idea that it was shockwaves off of the airfoils, off of the wings, causing these bad compressibility effects. That was an intellectual piece of knowledge they had just not arrived at. And that was important. I've often wondered about this, because you think of the Germans as being leaders in technology. Of course, after World War I, the Germans, because of the Versailles Treaty, their aeronautical work was, they weren't allowed to do any really serious airplane development, aeronautical work. And so they went into gliders. They did a lot of glider work in the 20s and the early 30s. But there's nothing there. I'm going to elaborate just one more minute. You know, again, talking about the NACA, had developed in the 1930s a series of nice, by a very systematic, logical approach, designed airfoil shapes. Prior to that, airfoil shapes were designed by totally ad hoc methods. World War I, it was whatever people wanted to draw with a French curve. A standard airfoil in the United States was a Clark Y airfoil. And Clark himself said in a 1928 article in what was then Aviation Week, or the equivalent of it, said, well, I designed my airfoils just by French curve. And it was lucky if it works and not unlucky if it doesn't work. It was all ad hoc. Along comes Eastman Jacobs in the variable density tunnel at Langley. And they start a systematic process of designing the shapes of airfoils and then testing these airfoils. And it led to the famous NACA, first four-digit airfoil series, then the five-digit airfoil series, and then ultimately the laminar flow shapes. And these were all laid out, and they were systematically understood and designed. And the reason I'm mentioning it this, what were the Germans doing? Germans were not designing their own airfoils. We have a Messerschmitt 109 at the Air and Space Museum. It's got an NACA airfoil on it. It's a very sort of specialized airfoil that the NACA had developed and tested, and it had a very sharp stall, and they did not recommend the use of it, but it had a low drag coefficient up at fairly high angles of attack, and then a sharp stall. So the Messerschmitt used an NACA airfoil. The Japanese Zero used an NAC airfoil. We have a Messerschmitt 262 twin jet fighter airplane. It's in the museum because it was the first jet fighter airplane that was manufactured in service. It has an NAC airfoil. So where were the Germans during all these days that airfoils were being designed by the NACA? Well, maybe they were just reading the NACA reports. Maybe they felt they didn't have to do the work. But I don't think. Yeah, right. There you go. But I've been very surprised that the Germans didn't do their own airfoil. And this is a long way of backing into saying, therefore, they were not paying attention intellectually, as to what was causing these adverse compressibility effects. That's my explanation for it. Thanks for asking. That's a good question to ask. Yes, yes. Yes, yes, yes. R.T. Jones. That little story here, swept wing.
Could you just repeat the question?
Yes, indeed. The comment was, didn't R.T. Jones, his name, a very famous NACA, basically theoretician and aerodynamicist, in the 1940s and later on, didn't he invent the swept wing? Well, it's interesting. Historians of engineering, historians of aerodynamics, you always look, who invented what? Who invented the jet engine? Well, Who invented the jet engine? There was a German by the name of Hans von Ohain. There was a British engineer, Frank Whittle. A couple of years later, who invented the jet engine? Well, it's been determined that for all practical purposes, they did it. They both get equal credit for inventing the jet engine. Okay, question. Who invented the swept wing? We have Otto Boussmann in 1935. And we have in 1944, R.T. Jones, who again, completely, none of the swept wing work in Germany was known to the public. It was all classified by the Luftwaffe. And so R.T. Jones didn't have any knowledge of what the Germans were doing, but he conjectured that for a high-speed missile with wings, that you'd want to sweep the wing to get up near Mach 1. So he was looking at swept wings. And the problem was, again, this was looked askance by some of the technical management at NACA headquarters. Finally, and he wrote a memo, I mean, it was down on paper, R.T. Jones' work on paper. When the Allied intelligence teams went into Germany, discovered all the swept wing work, Richard Schreier, who was the chief aerodynamicist, he was by that time for Boeing, they were designing a straight wing jet-powered bomber at Boeing. He saw this swept wing work. He said, wait a minute. And he sent the swept wing result back to Boeing. And he said, send it to other people. They also sent it to North America. And suddenly, what became the B-47 with swept wings was because of the swept wing work that they had discovered in Germany. The F-86, which was started out to be a straight wing fighter, ended up with swept wings because of this German data. Again, who invented that swept wing concept? Ultimately, and I had to make this kind of interpretation, because this question comes up frequently, that I will credit both of them, both Boussmann and R.T. Jones, for inventing the concept, although about 9 years separate the two. Boussmann did it in 35, R.T. Jones in 44. But because they didn't know about each other's work, they were done in basically vacuums of knowledge because of the wartime situation, they both get the credit for that. And I have to share with you, one thing about being at the Air and Space Museum, you have some interesting contacts. R.T. Jones's daughter sent me a letter a couple of years ago, actually expressing her thanks for, you know, saying, hey, he's the co-inventor of the swept wing, and sent me a lot of R.T. Jones's handwritten notes and memos associated with his work on the swept wing. It's really a good question. But that's it. I think they both co-invented the swept wing, although about 9 years separated them.
Okay. Before we formally thank Dr. Anderson, we have a reception outside, and there'll be more of an opportunity to talk to Dr. Anderson. And let's just thank him again for a great lecture. And thank everybody.
Thank you. Thanks, Roger. Appreciate this.